Good morning, and welcome to this virtual act of worship at Episcopal Church of the Transfiguration here on this third Sunday of Easter. So glad to share in this act of praise with you at your home, wherever you may be. We're glad you're sharing with us in it today. Before our worship begins, just a couple of brief notices. First, beginning immediately after the 9 o'clock service this morning on Sunday, there will be a class beginning, which will run for the next several weeks, exploring the topic of reconciliation. It is a topic that seems so pertinent for this season of Easter. So many of Jesus' resurrection appearances have to do with practicing or manifesting reconciliation with his disciples and with the world, and so we thought it appropriate to explore that topic together in the weeks to come. So beginning at 10:15 this morning, via a Zoom class, we'll be engaging in reflection on the nature of reconciliation. And I invite you to join us. Even if you're not yet registered, you still can by emailing Lana Medeiros, the executive assistant here at Transfiguration. Her email address is lmedeiros at transfiguration.net, and she can send you the information to be able to join us on this morning at 10:15 and in the coming several weeks on Sunday mornings at 10:15, and I hope you will. I'll also be leading a class on Wednesday evenings at 7 o'clock, exploring the resurrection appearances, a number of them, and considering the ways that they share with us stories of beauty, of inspiration, stories that are also deeply mysterious. And so I invite you to share in that class on Wednesday evenings, and you can also access that and gain access to that by emailing Lana, who will share with you all the information you need. This morning on this third Sunday of Easter, we are delighted to have as our preacher Dr. Roy Heller, professor of Old Testament at Perkins School of Theology at SMU, longtime member of our church, and usually on Sunday morning would be leading us in an exploration of the Hebrew Bible, and we were hoping was going to bring us to a conclusion of his multi-year exploration of the entirety of the Old Testament. It's on suspension right now as we are in our homes, but we're so glad that Roy is with us today as our preacher. Again, welcome to you all. Peace be with you. Our worship today on this third Sunday of Easter will begin in just a moment, after a brief time of quiet, with the chiming of the sacred bells.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
Alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, whose blessed Son made himself known to his disciples in the breaking of bread, open the eyes of our faith that we may behold him in all his redeeming work, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
A reading from the first letter of Peter. If you invoke as Father the one who judges all people impartially according to their deeds, live in reverent fear during the time of your exile. You know that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb, without defect or blemish. He was destined before the foundation of the world, but was revealed at the end of the ages for your sake. Through him you have come to trust in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are set on God. Now that you have purified your souls by your obedience to the truth, so that you have genuine mutual love, love one another deeply from the heart. You have been born anew, not of perishable, but of imperishable seed, through the living and enduring word of God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel of our Savior, Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now on that same day, two of the disciples were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him." Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at table with them, he took bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." When they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. The Gospel of our Savior.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
From the Gospel according to Luke, while they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
They are afraid, and they just want to go home. So much trauma during the past few days, so much pain, so much suffering, so much death. It seems like it will never end, and they just want to leave and go home. It's the only thing that they can imagine doing in the face of so much pain and suffering and death. And when the stranger asks why they are so sad, so dejected, the floodgates of grief open, and they cannot, it seems, stop talking. Their response is one of the longest speeches by any character besides Jesus in the entire Gospel of Luke. "Why are you both so sad?" he asks. "Jesus of Nazareth," they say, "a great prophet, one who was honored by both God and people, our own religious leaders, those people whom we trusted, handed him over to the Romans to be condemned and tortured and crucified. We had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem us, who would rescue us, who would help us. It's already been 3 days since that happened, and things aren't any better. Oh yeah, and just to make things worse, there were some women whom we know who went to the tomb early this morning. It doesn't even make any sense. They said that his body wasn't there, but then they had some sort of a vision about angels who said that he was alive. But that can't be true, because after that, some other people went to the tomb, and they didn't see his body either, but they didn't see Jesus or any angels or anything else at all. We're just so confused and afraid and sad. Can you hear the grief, the confusion, the suffering in their voices? Between the tears and sighs, all that pity, all that sadness, all that love just comes spilling out. They can't help it. And then the stranger says something remarkable. Yeah? So what? He seems to say. Haven't you ever taken a look at the prophets? Open up the prophets anywhere, read any scroll, and you can't miss this message. Bad things happen. There's never been a time, there never will be a time, when bad things won't happen. But the prophets also say this: the bad times are never, ever, ever the end of the story. There is always new life after the bad. Always. And so why, he seems to ask, so why, if you think that Jesus was so important, why do you expect that his life, his story, would be any different? Why do you think that bad things wouldn't be a part, maybe even the most important part, of his story as well? But God will never, ever, ever let that be the last act, the last scene in his story. It's the message over and over and over throughout all the prophets, and in fact throughout the whole scripture. There will be suffering, but suffering never has the last word, he tells them. And then something amazing happens. Something remarkable happens. Although they're grieving, although they're suffering, because of all that pain and grief and death, they ask that stranger to stay with them. In the midst of their pain, they extend hospitality. Why did they do it, these two men who are afraid and only wanted to go home? I suspect they did it for the same reason why those women went to the tomb so early that morning. I suspect they did it for the same reason that those other men ran from their hiding place to that tomb that morning as well. And in fact, they did it for the same reason why they themselves have been weeping. In the words of Bishop Michael Curry, they did it because love compelled them to do so. Please stay with us, because it's almost night. And there, at their dining room table, the stranger takes bread and blesses it and breaks it and hands it to them. And suddenly he is no stranger at all. But of course, as soon as they recognize him, they don't see him anymore. As soon as they recognize him, they don't need to see him. A few weeks ago, before Easter, I saw a meme, a posting online that said, "I wasn't planning on giving up quite this much for Lent." And I saw another one that said, "This is the lentiest Lent that I've ever lented." And it's true. From the end of Epiphany until now seems like the longest 3 months we've perhaps ever lived. So much given up. So much lost, so much suffering and grief, and yes, so much death of all kinds, physical, emotional, spiritual. But I suggest to you also that perhaps this year in 2020, this Easter is also the Easterest Easter that we've ever Eastered. You see, in most years, that Easter proclamation, Alleluia, Christ is risen, the Lord is risen indeed, Alleluia, during the Easter vigil, marks a definite point in time when Lent is done away with and Eastertide has begun. In one moment, we're quiet and still and in darkness. And in just a few seconds, we're singing and ringing bells and laughing, and our Easter bonnets are bobbing, and the triptych is open, and we see Jesus all in white, and the organ is playing, and the timpani are booming, and the horns are blaring, and everything is light and happy and joyful. Thank God Lent is over, we say. Probably not outwardly, but probably inwardly. Oh, we got through that another year. In one moment, all of our grief and our loss and our giving up stuff is turned to joy and abundance and getting stuff again. All at once, just like flipping a switch. We're opening a triptych. But that's not really how things are in real life most of the time, is it? One moment grieving and just a few seconds later rejoicing. One moment suffering and in just the next, not a care in the world. One moment dying and in the next second fully alive. That's not how it is most of the time in our real lives, in our real world. It takes time. It's not sudden. And appropriately, that is actually, it's not how it is in Scripture either. In all four gospel accounts, what we find on Sunday morning are shell-shocked, grieving, traumatized people. For the most part, they're sheltered in place, not wanting to go outside, unsure of the next few days or the next few weeks. They have no idea what's supposed to come next. And when Jesus does appear to them, well, actually, not much changes with them, in fact, at least not at first. And in the Gospel of Luke, this is even more apparent. When the resurrected Jesus appears in that gospel, it's a rare thing, only twice. And those two appearances are mysterious. They're never clear. People see him, but they don't recognize him. Or if they do recognize him, they're still not sure. Even when Jesus appears, people are still wary and afraid, and maybe even unbelieving. You see, brothers and sisters, that Easter joy did not come immediately, like the flipping of a switch or the opening of a triptych. That faith in the resurrected Lord came gradually, in fits and starts, over the course of nearly a month and a half, with the disciples experiencing that resurrection, experiencing Jesus, here and there, in short, fleeting encounters. They experienced him often in community, when they were together, but sometimes they experienced him in a home, around a table, and through a small meal shared in love. You see, it takes time for the heart to restart after all that kind of trauma and grief and fear that the disciples experienced. It takes time, but that's all right. Jesus, seen or unseen, never left them. He stayed right there with them throughout. So you see, that's why I think that this year, in 2020, this year may contain the Easterest Easter that we've ever Eastered. We have a unique opportunity in the midst of so much pain and suffering, and yes, death across our county and across our nation and world. This year, we didn't get to experience together the lights and sounds and sudden rush of joy during that definite moment in time when darkness turns to light and quiet turns into explosive sound. This year, we're given the chance to experience our risen Lord like those first disciples. Perhaps in fits and starts, gradually here and there, in fleeting moments, lived out in love. Sure, there will be bad times, and in fact, bad times will continue, no doubt. But make no mistake about this. He is risen. And if we're honest, that fact is a lot to take in. It shouldn't surprise us that we don't get it all at once. It takes time and fits and starts, with hopeful steps forward and sometimes with tragic steps backwards. If this year you don't feel very Eastery, take heart. If maybe you feel weepy or anxious or sad, it's okay. You're in good company. The company of apostles and disciples with the women and men of that first Easter morning. But in the midst of it all, we may still see him. And in fact, we do still see him. Usually when we aren't looking for him, and most of the time when we least expect it. Perhaps in an uplifting or encouraging note or email. Perhaps in a kind gesture. Perhaps in a shared meal. And perhaps in a moment of grace and beauty and peace, in a time and a place where we expected only fear and grief and maybe even death. And while we continue on our journey with our seen and unseen Lord, we're like those women in the darkness of that early morning. And we're like those men who ran to the tomb. We are like that kindly couple who, in the midst of their sorrows and sadness, extended a loving invitation and a warm meal to a stranger on the way. During this Easter, especially this Easter, we allow that love who made us and who's with us, we allow that love to compel us on our way. That love, that Lord, is risen indeed. Alleluia. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead, and the life of the world to come. Amen.
rejoicing in the resurrection of Jesus Christ and remembering our role as stewards of creation, let us offer our prayers to God, the Maker and Redeemer of the world. That in the face of the darkness and fear of our world, we may hold fast to the joy and hope of the resurrection. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Alleluia.
That isolated and persecuted Christians may find fresh strength in the good news of Easter. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Alleluia.
That we may not fear evil or death, and have courage to love one another as Christ loves us. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Alleluia.
That the Holy Spirit will inspire the leaders of the nations with wisdom to guide us through the pandemic and serve the needs of all people. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Alleluia.
That those living in the shadow of sickness and death may receive strength and hope. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Alleluia.
That all who minister to the sick will be blessed and protected. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Alleluia.
That we will be humbly and truly grateful for the good earth entrusted to our care and love it as Christ loves it. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Alleluia.
That we will accept our responsibility as stewards of our world and repent from all waste, greed, and negligence. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Alleluia.
That we will live in a way that leaves a healthier and more verdant world for those who come after us. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Alleluia.
That we may share with all who have died in the hope of the resurrection at the eternal banquet of Christ. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Alleluia. Almighty God, you have entrusted us with a sacred responsibility to care for the world you made. Give us wisdom in our use of the resources of nature, that no one may suffer from our abuse of them, and grant that we, remembering the account that we must one day give, may be faithful stewards of this fragile earth, our island home. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom all things came into being and in whom all things experience redemption and healing.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Will you please join us in praying together our concluding prayer? Come, Lord Jesus, and dwell in my heart in the fullness of your strength. Be my wisdom and guide me in right pathways. Conform my life and actions to the image of your holiness. And in the power of your gracious might, rule over every hostile power that threatens the safety of your people or disturbs the growth of your kingdom. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, in glory everlasting. Amen.
May Christ travel with us on all our journeys. May Christ be present with us in times of worry and grief. May Christ be known to us in the breaking of the bread, in the beauty of the earth, and in all his redeeming work. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you this day and remain with you always.
Amen. Amen.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia.